And this, the direction of the alpha spurs will be just superior to the calcar and in axis with the neck. Next comes the beta spurs, which is exactly posterior and superior aspect of the configuration. That is the beta hole. Here also we use the same 3.5 mm drill bit. Once this alpha and beta screws are put, let's go on to the head screws. The tip of the head, that is just below the bullet tip, is called the head screws. In these head screws, we can use a 5.7 cannulated cancellous locking screws. Okay, the final configuration will be to put first. To begin the surgery, we have to put always the alpha and the beta screws. The purpose of naming the alpha and the beta was just to give a reference point where your position of the plate is very ideal and it sits properly in the lateral aspect of the trochanteric region. Once the alpha and beta screws are placed, distally we have to put the locking screws. Can use the 4.5 mm locking screws. You usually have a universal drill guide where you can, with the help of a drill guide, you can go either for the cortical or the locking 4.5. We will be showing in theory and all the practical aspects of the plate, how to place the plate and what are the ideal step by step in the workshops. Okay.
This is how we have been using for the last 5 years. You can call it as a marriage between a regular distal femur cobra plate and a locking plate. It gives two important things. Like if you have a distal femur plate, which was the old age-old plates, you get polyaxial. You can put it in whichever direction you like to place. And at the same time, later on came a concept of locking concept. So this combines both. It gives an advantage of having a polyaxiality. At the same time, the furthermore one more advantage of having a locking plate phenomenon. So this is one plate which probably we may not be using on a regular basis, on a day-to-day basis. We've been using this plate for a very complex situations. We have been using this plate, you reverse this distal femur plate proximally for those kind of fractures where there is a proximal subtrochanteric fractures with bone loss are severely comminuted. You primarily you nail it over which or next when the patient comes for 6 weeks and you feel that it's not that much stable, use this plate, reverse the opposite side plate screws and at the same time bone graft it. That is one study we have been doing for the last 4 years. Results are yet to be published. Some patients are doing well. Some of the cases probably will be seeing tomorrow. And the other thing, this distal femur, we will use this plate usually in periprosthetic fractures around in a total knee, after a total knee replacement. So what is this advantages that it has is that it's again a titanium plate. You have spaces. It will prevent the plate abutting very closely to the bone and you spaces. After that you put the screws in whichever direction you like to place and at the same time after that you lock it over a cap, which has a cap. This is the spacer that has, which is, that's why it's called as non-contact bridging distal femur system. This is the spacer which will prevent the plate abutting tightly over to the periosteum so that the periosteum blood supply is not altered. In this, we fix the fractures, you use spaces, and you fix the fractures in whichever direction. You have a 30 degree axiality. We have a jig which will, if you make sure that jig is firmly in contact with the plate and you drill it, you will not cross more than 30 degrees. If you are deviating properly, the locking system and the screw may not be placed properly. And this is the locking head that, and it has again, just like you have your locking screwdrivers, there's a click and it locks firmly. And this probably may not be used on a regular basis, probably more of in complex situations you can use this split. But however, once you start using it, usually you love this split using it, because it will give an advantage of putting screws in whichever direction, wherever the bone contact is good, you place it and then lock it, and the principle is the same of having a LCP. That's all. Thank you.
The next thing is distal medial tibial plate. It is usually used for pilot fracture. So this plate is rather than the surgical demonstration there on the video clip. But clinically, what we need to know is this is very useful in a pilot fracture where the pilot is subluxated anteromedially, and to some extent it's useful in anterolateral subluxation also. But this doesn't work when there is a postlateral subluxation. There you need to have some implant which is going on the posterior side, which is giving a buttress on the posterior side. The one thing we need to know, the instrumentation, those things you can learn on the table. So the pilot fracture, what we need to know is alignment and length. So the length is achieved by proper reduction of fibula. Once the fibula is reduced, you know the length. So after that, if you can fix the fibula, then you usually go postlateral exposure and fix the fibula. And then it is preferable to do an anteromedial incision so that the bridge of the skin is more. But practically, anteromedial incision, you will not be able to reach the anterolateral aspect. So in some cases, you need to have a midline exposure where your proximal external incision should be minimal. Then your chance of skin necrosis is less. And this plate, the distal screw will go parallel to the joint line. Since it is a completely locking plate construct, there is no plate reduction. So you have to reduce the fracture, then place the plate. So you have to achieve anatomical reduction, then only you have to place the plate. The distal screws will go parallel to the joint line. After that, if you want a compression, then you have to pull the plate proximally, or the compression by your technique, and lock it proximally. And since it is a locking construct, the plate should be of a longer distance, and the screw should be as minimal as possible to hold the fracture. If you overdo, means if you put too many screws, it is going to cause stress shielding, and you will have difficulty in fracturing healing. And in pilon fracture, the distal fragment is the difficult fragment is the postlateral fragment. To reduce that, you need to open the fracture, take the anterolateral fragment out, and reduce the postlateral fragment, probably stabilize the K-bar, then do all this reduction on this. So that would be useful. Okay, so this screw is going on the posterior, this will be holding the posterior lateral fragment. So unless you reduce it and then put this screw, then if the reduction is not proper, then your ankle is going to subluxate posterior laterally, and long term patient will end up in osteoarthritis. So when putting this plate, the most important thing is you need to have anatomical reduction before you place the plate. And how we do it, that probably you can see it on demos.